A very good morning to all of you. We are very excited by your presence here today at the inaugural session of the Third Tribes in Transition Conference on the theme Indigenous Cultures in the Digital Era. This event is being held under the aegis of Department of English, Jamia Millia Islamia, and presided over by Professor Asaduddin, Dean of the Faculty of Humanities and Languages, Jamia. We will be recording all the sessions of the conference. And at the same time, it's being live streamed on YouTube channel for our registrants and subscribers. We kindly request all the participants to post their queries in the chat box. Our volunteers will try to address them all. Our reporters for this session are Faizan and Usama. I would request the participant also to mute them until and unless it is required. Now I invite Professor Simi Malhotra, head of the Department English, to begin the proceedings with the welcome speech. Welcome, ma'am, over to you.
Right. Thank you so much, Vasundhara. Professor Anvita Abdi, our keynote speaker this morning and her evening or late night actually. Professor M. Asaduddin, our Dean of Faculty of Humanities and of course the advisor to the Vice Chancellor and a very, very dear colleague of ours, Dr. Ivy Hanstak, the convener and the main force behind this particular conference. All other participants who have joined us, as also old colleagues from the department, Professor Shyamala Narayan, as also all the other colleagues from the Department of English, and also from all over the country who joined this particular morning. I want to welcome all of you on behalf of the Department of English to this particular conference, which is an international conference on tribes in transition three, indigenous cultures in the digital era. You will hear more about the conference from my colleague, who's the convener of the conference, Dr. Ivy Hanstak. But I want to welcome all of you to this conference. This is a very special conference to the department, and I'm really grateful to my colleague, Dr. Ivy Hanstak, for not only putting together this conference in such a short time, but being able to actually gather together some of the best minds in the field and offering us what is going to be an absolute academic treat and a stimulating intellectual treat for all of us. So I'm really grateful to Dr. Ivy Hanstak for taking this initiative, for putting together this conference, and for inviting such important people to this conference. And we are really, really eagerly looking forward to it. I'm particularly grateful to Professor Abhi, the keynote speaker of this morning, who's actually stayed up so late at night. She's been an old teacher and such a and an institution unto herself. And I'm really grateful to Professor Asaduddin, who gives unstinting support to all the programs that we organize here in the department. His support means everything to the department and to us. So I'm really grateful to him. And of course, I'm very, very grateful to Dr. Ivy Hanstak for this excellent, excellent treat of a conference that she's put together. And of course, I'm very grateful to all the participants and all the people who've joined us to be part jo joined us as part of this conference. And last but not the least, to Vasundhara and to Kanupriya for who've been working so hard in putting together the conference, and to all the student volunteers and all the researchers who are part of this conference. So I extend a very warm welcome to all of you, and I'm really looking forward to this session and to all the sessions to follow after this. Thank you so much. A warm welcome from the department and from Jamia. So welcome all of you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for such a warm welcome. It's always pleasant listening to you. I now invite the convener of the conference, Dr. Ivy Hansda, to introduce the theme of the conference. Welcome, ma'am, over to you.
Thank you, Vasudha. Respected Professor Asaduddin, respected Professor Anvita Abhi, respected Professor Simi Malhotra, and all my dear invited speakers, colleagues, friends, and research scholars. I begin by wishing you all a very good morning, or whatever timings you have, good afternoon or good evening. This conference is the third in a series of tribes in transition conferences organized by me since 2014 under the aegis of the Department of English, Jamia Millia Islamia Central University. The first one was on the theme conflict over identity, resources, and development, and was held in collaboration with the tribal NGO Goshaldanga Bishnupati Adivasi Trust on 12th and 13th March 2014 at Shanti Niketan, West Bengal. The second one was on the theme reaffirming indigenous identity through narrative, and was held jointly with Jamia Outreach Program on 27th and 28th February 2017 at Jamia Millia Islamia. After a gap of 4 years, this third conference is being held on the theme Indigenous Cultures in the Digital Era, but apparently with a marked difference. At a superficial level, this conference is a webinar and the conference hall is the online Zoom platform. But at a deeper and more profound level, there is a common thread binding these three conferences together. Here, I would like to quote a few words from a similar speech at the second conference. While benefiting from affirmative action in some cases, Adivasis or indigenous people in India also feel the claustrophobic confines of their identity, which has been imposed on them by others, be it the colonial administrator, the colonial anthropologist, the missionary, or the neoliberal, neo-imperialist forces that rule global economy today. This conference will strive to change our ways of looking at the Adivasi so that identity becomes a source of strength and celebration instead of shame and silence. Since those words were spoken in 2017, many changes have occurred in our midst. The world has seen the ravages of climate change and pandemic. Today, we are learning to live in a situation of isolation where our dependence on technology has increased manifold. At the same time, the last few years have also seen the sudden mushrooming of social media sites where diverse groups have started connecting with each other across the globe, across wide spaces. Most recently, since the COVID-19 lockdowns were imposed by governments across the world, the traditional classroom has been replaced by the virtual one, and our knowledge system has also moved into new and unfamiliar areas. This conference is an attempt to study the changes happening amongst the indigenous and tribal people of India. Does this digitization of knowledge affect everyone equally? Do the rural and tribal groups of India adapt to these changes, or do they employ new strategies to hold on to their old identities? Has the digital era brought new hope for the tribals, or has it alienated them even more? Finally, has a time arrived when the indigenous and tribal people of the world will contribute their ancient wisdom to the new system of knowledge? These are some of the questions that will be discussed during the conference. With these few words, I would like to conclude my introduction to the theme. I thank all the invited speakers who have accepted the invitation to share their valuable knowledge with us at this gathering. And I also thank the audience for spending their valuable time listening to these discussions. I wish you all a stimulating experience during this conference. Good day to you all.
Thank you, ma'am, for setting the tone of the conference. It's a new area of study for many of us. We will now proceed to the keynote address by Padma Shri Professor Anvita Abbi, formerly Professor of Linguistics in Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Professor Anvita Abbi is known today for her pioneering work on many tribal and oral languages of South Asia. She did her PhD from Cornell University, USA, and then taught in many countries besides India, including the USA, Germany, Australia, UK, and Canada. She knows 6 languages, Hindi, English, French, Punjabi, Bengali, and Sanskrit. She has authored 18 books, among them Semantic Grammar of Hindi, A Study of Reduplication, published in 1980s, Studies in Bilingualism, published in 1986, Semantic Universals in Indian Languages, published in 1994, Languages of Tribal and Indigenous People of India, The Ethnic Space, published in 1997, Endangered Languages of the Andaman Islands, published in 2006, Dictionary of the Great Andamanese Language, published in 2012, Grammar of the Great Andamanese Language, an Ethnographic Study, published in 2013, and Routes to Oral Literature, published in 2018. Her most recent publication is Voices from the Lost Horizon, Stories and Songs of the Great Andamanese, where she introduces us to the stories and ballads of the dying languages of the Andaman Islands. For her outstanding work on India's endangered languages, she was conferred with the Rashtriya Lok Bhasha Samman in 2003, the Padma Shri Award in 2013, and the Kenneth Hale Award in 2015. She has also been the honorary director of the Center of Oral and Tribal Literature, Sahitya Academy, New Delhi, and the president of the Linguistic Society of India. Presently, she is holding the B.B. Borkar Chair of Comparative Literature, Goa University. I now invite Padma Shri Professor Anvita Abbi to deliver the keynote speech. Welcome, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you, Vasundhara, for introducing me so elaborately. I was very conscious. Thank you, Professor Asaduddin, for chairing this and hosting us, or hosting me, I should say, Dr. Ivy Hansdag, whom I have known for quite some years, and she's doing a commendable job in promoting tribal literature and tribal ethos. And my very old and dear student, I still consider Rissimi. She may be a professor now, but to me, she's an old girl. So I'm so happy to see all of you, and I'm very honored to be addressing you this morning, my night. So I tried not to doze off while I'm speaking, but it's very nice to have you among all of us. Let me try to share my screen. And if I have any, let's see. Is it okay? Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
All right. Okay. I'll touch a couple of, there are many, many issues, you know, with the tribal life, the culture, the language, and the digitization. However, I will touch a few issues only in this keynote. And mainly I'll be sharing my experiences and my feelings. I'm not a student of literature, but I have known tribes, I think I should say, or the Adivasis from the grassroots level, because I am a very, very compulsive field worker, and I have spent a lot of time in my life being with them in the field, in their villages, in the jungles, or on the seashores, wherever they live. In fact, I've spent a long life among tribes of India, drawn from lower Himalayas to Andaman and then Nicobar Islands, because right now I'm documenting two languages of the Nicobar Islands. And before coming to the United States, I was actually in Nicobar collecting my data. So if you look at the southernmost tip in the Indian map, I must have been there, you see. So it had been a very enjoyable journey. But my main concern had been to capture the linguistic structures and trying to see why the grammars of these languages are so very different from the ones we are accustomed to use. In addition to grammar, what is striking about tribal languages is their poetry, which they sing on any pretext. The structure of the poetry is simple, as it has melody and rhythm. However, under the simplicity lies heavy symbolism, and it is very difficult, almost impossible, to match the translation to its original, as each and every referent is contextualized and bears cultural significance, tribal beliefs and values. And here, you know, the linguists really sometimes at a loss. They do not know what to do. Unless an outsider spends long time with the tribes, it is not easy to understand the meaning of the poetry, which may appear simple and straight at the outset. In fact, tribal poetry is ahead of postmodernism. Most of the tribal literature is oral in nature, as you all know, and continue because it continuously evolves. And it is current to the political, socio-political situation, if you must have noticed, most of the songs and the oral literature of the tribes incorporates the most amazing and the most important and relevant issues in politics. The tribal literature also does not know the boundaries between various performing arts. So there's a dance, gestures, rhythm, above all, symbolism. Everything is weaved into one. Oral literature of tribes does not know the other boundaries also, like the boundary of the what you consider written and the oral, because there everything infuses in the oral form. All forms are interwoven into one whole with marked feature of the specificity of the time of rendering. And time of rendering is very important. The frankness and the boldness of the expression that I have seen in tribal poetry has no match with the written literature. The satire and metaphors used in tribal poetry can be considered exotic by Eurocentric approach, but not by the locals, as this rendering is part of everyday life. Tribes live in and with nature. Imagine what will be the world like when there's scissor of intergeneration transfer. What catastrophe we will face when youth stop speaking the heritage language? Because what I have realized over the years that language is a rule governed, as you all know, but it is culture-driven phenomena. Tribes live for and they live and in nature. Any act of destruction of nature and its natural environment is seen as a truncation of a part of their life. And many Munda and Santhali poems are there which depict this very clearly, leading to incompleteness or desolation. As languages are succinct witnesses of the diverse and varying ways in which the human cognitive faculties perceive the world, their grammars and dictionaries are rich source of information about the unique worldviews of speakers of these languages. And perhaps as many of you know that I have written quite a bit about the great Andamanese worldview, which is very unique. Languages not only manifest various ecological and archaeological signatures of the communities that maintain close ties to the environment, but are also important repositories of a shared human history, shared human civilization. The views of exotic is view of an outsider, as the tribal poetry of India reflects and represents true nature of their lives, which is very distinct from the mainstream Indians, I should say. Tribes take recourse in heavy symbolism, which are opaque to the outside world, but are cherished within the community members. Their utmost desire is to be left undisturbed. However, they are not left undisturbed. Constant subjugation of tribes physically and emotionally has rendered them on the margins of the society, where they aspire to be merged in the mainstream. And youth feel happy, unfortunately, to forget their traditions, language, culture, history, and indigenous knowledge. I have witnessed mass linguicide, I would say, in Kuruk community in the 90s. Most of the tribal culture, as you all know, is animistic in nature. According to the animist perspective, consciousness is present in all natural and supernatural phenomena, in animals, in ancestral spirits, and in geographical features such as stones, rivers, and mountains. And my latest book, which is when I received Voices from the Lost Horizon, the stories of that book very clearly depicts this. Their existence is holistic to submerge in the ecology of as one within and not the one out of it. Why I'm mentioning all this to you, really? You must be wondering. Because my heart bleeds today when I encounter community after community deprived of intergeneration transfer of heritage, language, and culture, who are oblivious of the fact that they have lost or they are losing gradually their utmost important treasure, and that is their mother tongue. I think I need water. UNESCO has affirmed 2019 the start of an international decade of indigenous language. By doing so, they had renewed a long-standing clear-on call that language rights are a core aspect of human rights. We can help in this goal in promoting digitization of language, digitization of culture and traditions, and of course, the worldview. Within this ecosystem, I am reminded of a Wancho tribe living in the Northeast, belonging to the Tibeto-Burman language group. Their sense of kinship extends to embrace the entire natural environment. And the folk stories reinforce the protective role towards biodiversity that is assigned to human intervention. Respect for elders, Apu Api, as they know, is foundational to Wancho tradition. And here, on your screen, this is from the Wancho tradition. Let me see if I can play the.
Nang aw, nang fan paywa, nang man fang laman no. Ay agan koy kaban, manthang le agan koy pu, manthang le agan koy.
See, this is, I'm going to explain to you shortly that this is actually animation of the traditions, the cultural traditions of the Apu Api, done by Tara Douglas, and how digitization has helped the youth and the younger generation to love their traditions and to love their culture. There's another one, which is the Great Andamanese folktale, which was published by the National Book Trust. I collected long ago. This is a story of Pherta Jido. Pherta Jido was the first human being which they considered was born out of a hollow of a bamboo. It's a complete story, you know, which brings us into effect the absolute idealism. And I this story is also included in fullest form in the latest book of Voices from the Lost Horizon. This is the latest book, and now it's easily available from Amazon also. And in fact, you can see the cover of this book behind me right now. And this story is the creation myth. There are two creation myths, but Pherta Jido is amazing because it has all the five elements of life mentioned in the story. It's woven into it, but it's a very metaphysical story also, and you have to read it to find out what I'm trying to say, that it's because we could digitize this whole story. It's available in the audio form and also by the interlinear translation and the running translation, that we have this wonderful cultural record of the community. This book also comes out with the QR code. So when you scan the QR code, you can hear and you can see the video. So that is a new thing about the digitization that has taken into place. You don't need a CD and you don't need a pen drive. You just need a QR code and takes you to the site where you can see the oldest civilization living on this earth, singing and narrating stories. And this is all, fortunately, is made possible because of the digitization. So digitizing tribal languages and cultures is a step towards fighting discrimination. And I strongly believe this discrimination, which is against linguistic apartheid, that has created a gulf between what is written and what is not written down. Our education policy, as you know, had been defective. It has been non-inclusive, thereby has created a rift between language being recognized in schools and languages those are not recognized in schools, or those which are enshrined in script and those which are not. It has totally ignored the oral tradition of the country. Currently, India has more than 800 languages that remain in oral forms. Surprising is the fact that these have survived for thousands of years despite the rampant globalization, homogenization, industrialization, and neglect of their speech and culture. How this has happened? Have you ever asked why this has happened? And I think this is because this is the power of orality and intergeneration transfer. So once the intergeneration transfer ceases, then we will lose this. Or once the oral tradition is lost, we will always see this. As I just said, the languages are not equally divided in the country. This is the situation. If I take all the Indian languages, you come across a kind of a pyramid kind of a structure where English is on the top. Then comes the scheduled languages. Then there are dialects of scheduled languages. Then there are non-scheduled languages, 98 of them. And there are dialects of non-scheduled languages, or you can call varieties of scheduled non-scheduled languages, are 50 of them. But ironically, then there are more large number of languages which are spoken by less than 10,000 speakers. And they are not even reported in any census. And they are the ones which are mostly tribal or Adivasi languages. Those are the ones which are tucked into remotest corners of the country. And these are the ones where they are very ancient civilization still exists. So this is a situation, current situation of Indian languages. One can say that, well, there are so many languages, 272 classified languages and more than 1,000, or more than 800 unwritten languages, I should say. However, the speedy rate of language endangerment is known to all of us. And languages are being lost because of the breakdown of traditional societies, because of the forced migration, or I would say dislocation of tribes in the name of development. Somebody should ask them, development for whom, or development of whom? Mass globalization is destroying this world of environmental and linguistic diversity. A sure step for extinction of human race. We had been, unfortunately, we had been mute spectators of voices being fallen to silence. Let us save this earth from being depleted of biocultural diversity. Digitization is the only way to sustain and revive the languages. Sustenance of orality can be undertaken only through digitization. And we have made some progress in it. We have made an effort, so we know that it works. Orality is preserved in digitization through audio-video files, thus does not run the risk of frozen culture. It can be saved and shared on social media platform, uncensored with all the indigenous nuances. There is a very famous linguist who had been working on language revival for last two decades, Gilhard Zukerman. He opines that language revival is the key to mental well-being of a society. And this can be made possible only through language digitization. There are other studies which have been made in linguistics which show correlation between language knowledge and mental health. And they also show that loss of cultural collapse and rise in public health issues. So there's a kind of a correlation. Having said this, the question comes, who are the important players to undertake digitization? And there are two types, or two kinds. One is linguists, language lovers, folklorists, and also the very important part is played by the community itself. A new field has emerged called documentation linguistics, which I am not going into detail about it in the last 30 years. But what is important to know is that it involves producing interactive lexicon, dictionary, grammar, interlinear translation of sentences. I'll come to that. This is very important. Generally, the translation misses on the interlinear translation. Linguists know how to do it. Ecological knowledge, indulging medicinal plants, herbs available in the surroundings, and oral tradition that may include, among others, songs, ballads, lullaby, healing songs, quite a few of them, oral epics, performing arts, etc. So orality is preserved in digitization through audio-video files and thus does not run the risk of frozen culture, as I said. Documentary linguistics does not produce material just for linguists. Rather, the products of language documentation are meant to have broad and meaningful societal impact. And in fact, a new book has come just the other day, and I can show you, if you can see this cover here. the Why Language Documentation Matters by Shobhana Chalya. And this is an important aspect that she also considers why it is important. Coming to interlinear translation, which I said is very important, because what interlinear translation really promotes in the part of digitization is one has to translate each and every morpheme. And many times there are many aspects which are left unexplained if you just go for word-to-word translation, not if you don't go for interlinear translation. For example, let me tell you, written one is there are two kinds of that. So just THAT, that could be either visible or non-visible. One has to specify, and this is also true in Mundari and many other Austroasiatic Munda languages. So there are two kinds of that. Similarly, there are different inflection markers may indicate level of respect and honorability or honorificity. For example, in Magahi, or the body division markers that every grammatical category takes in Great Andamanese basically shows the inalienability of different states, events, and the speaker. Or if you take the Northeastern language like Lamkang verb, we'll discover that how speakers indicate who did what to whom and when. And there are also languages in the Himalayan region, especially in the hilly areas, where they have many different words tagged at the end of the sentence, which may appear to be empty, but is actually are evidential markers. And they tell you that whether the event has been seen by somebody, or it has been a hearsay, or it has been just thought about that it happened. So these are very important messages which get lost in just simple translation. But if you do interlinear translation, it emotes what is the culture of the community which uses this language. There's another important aspect, which is also, you can say, part of digitization, is that is to bring unwritten languages under the umbrella of orthography. That's an important part, because without that, we cannot write and we cannot promote literacy in the community also. We did this effort in 2008. The Great Andamanese Varnamala was prepared by us, and the tribe who gave me the information on this, now junior, I called him on the stage and he was also honored as a co-author. So this was very important. As far as the folklorist's role is concerned, they give a very holistic panorama of cultural life through audio video recordings of stories, fables, and myths. This is a very rich area, both in content and number of participants. The entire community may be involved. In fact, they should be recording and uploading it on social media. And I'm aware of now, this awareness has come in various communities. When we were working in Bastar area in Jharkhand, we realized that there are few tribes who have been uploading their community aspects, their cultural aspects onto the social media. But before that, I'll just give you a couple, just two short videos, which our team recorded when we reached Andaman, you know, and how the digitization has helped preserving this, the only musical instrument that the Great Andamanese had. And if you just listen to this carefully, that how we also elicit why this, what is this called and why it is called this. And the second strip the next one that I'll play will also show you how this musical instrument is played. So,
इसको क्या बोलते हैं ये जो है नीचे रखा हुआ क्या बुआमो
बुआमो
बुआमो मतलब क्या होता
है ये हम लोग का ढोलक को बोलते हैं बुआमो बोलने से बुआ बोलने से जमीन जमीन में बजाना
जमीन में बजाना
See, so the person is also explaining that it is like a dholak, because he knows that we understand dholak. Now he is simulating it with dholak, but it's not a dholak at all. I'll just show you that why it is not a dholak. And he also tells that it is a boa mo, because boa means earth and it is put on the land and then it is played. Now, so much information this tribe has, this person had, and he's not an educated person, but he understands even the meaning. The word that is being used for this is medical, the musical instrument. And here he says, and this here he says that if you fill it with the kankar patthar, that is with stones, it sounds better. And then he asks him to play, and this is how it is played. It's a simple instrument which is made of bark of a tree. And this is the only musical instrument I was surprised to see Great Andamani's head, but they dance to this rhythm that the guy is, thumping on. So this is how, the community can record some of the things which are gone out of their daily lives, but it can be preserved and digitized. And then the younger generation also feels motivated to retain it and to revive it back. This is another one, which is I was telling you about, from the Halbi tribe. And this is a digitization, extensive digitization has been done by one of the Adivasi. And he has uploaded on YouTube. This is Athe Jagar. It's a festival which prolongs for 3-4 days, day and night. And this is nothing, it's a bow. And the way they strike this bow, it becomes a musical instrument. So have a look. So what I was trying to say that the community members have to participate in the digitization, and they can be helped by the folklorists and linguists to do this. So now the key players in digitization is not just those technological people that you think we are or some people are, but the people where this culture belongs to, people who speak this language, or people whose civilization we are trying to protect. Don't forget that folklore is the collective cultural heritage of the community. Indigenous cultures worldwide have been consistent. A sensitive approach that prioritizes accurate representation of detail is very, very vital. And diligent research of the traditions is essential to avoid subverting the original meaning of the text and appropriating the story for one's own ends. Many in the past misrepresented tribes as primitive, archaic, outdated, and stagnant, but no longer people are realizing these languages are heritage languages, and people have those retained are one of the people from the ancient civilizations. They are the treasure trove. And myths and folklore have always been very popular in media. The Walt Disney Studios have been using it, as what we have to do in this digitization process, we have to make the format interesting, and we have to engage the youth. It's only the youth who can salvage this. Documenting with different media gives it more authenticity than just writing a document about it. So we have to use all these audiovisual medias, and of course the social media has to be taken help of. And this also brings me to an animation. Recently a lot of tribes have been trained into doing animation films, because they don't want to use their own faces, but they want to do animation. And some animation filmmakers have been taking interest. This is the next I can show you. Sorry. This is again made by Tara Douglas, who's a promoter of pixelated animation. And she had been training the Wancho tribes how to make animated figure and indicate their ancient civilization and culture. So this is still not complete. The sound has yet to be given, but this is how the animation and they can be given. There was a workshop being done in Manipur University, and large number of people came and attended the workshop. So if you help the tribes to survive their ancient culture, this is one of the ways, of doing it. There is another, the storytelling is a very important aspect that we have to consider by developing media content that is based on local storytelling tradition. The homogenization of local cultures by external media can be avoided. So one has to take into that account. Since language encodes perception, digital media can encapsulate unique vocabulary of tribal languages, which may have no match in English or any state language. And I am reminded of, I can give large number of examples because I've been working on so many languages and I always come across very unique vocabulary. The 9 different shades of blue in Maya language, which cannot be translated, or 6 different seashores, names of 6 different seashores, because depending upon the level of the water that there is in Great Andamanese, or various different names of smell. We collected 18 different names of smell in Great Andamanese, and 10 different names of smell of burning in Munda, or various different names of mushrooms in Mulukurumba. I have some pictures of Mulukurumba mushrooms because everybody has now, after the tea plantation, the mushroom crop had been destroyed and people don't recognize the varieties of mushrooms. So what they do that every mushroom is called kume, and I'll skip this. This is a diversity of rice in Koraput. I think I had the mushroom one. Wait, huh? These are the ones just talking about. So this is also kume, and this is also kume. This is also kume. This is also kume. Each mushroom had a different name, different medicinal properties, and different taste. But it is lost to the community because they have been destroyed. So then, if the nature is destroyed, then the information also gets destroyed. Similarly, in Koraput district, I was told that in 1950 survey, they established 1,700 types of rice. But after the Green Revolution, all that was mitigated, and they say Sarkari Dhan does not taste any good. And they've forgotten the names of these rice, 1,500 names of the rice, their taste, the way they grow. But had it been digitized, had the information been collected through video and pictures, we would have been much more enlightened. Some of the names are here on your screen, but they are not all. I mean, I said this has been. So in a way, this digitization process has brought a sea change in our research. There has been a shift of the role of the researchers from an expert to one of facilitator. And this is a direction for collaborating with tribes to represent their cultural heritage. With the help of linguists and language lovers, folklorists, community members have come forward and have started digitizing their cultural heritage and language. This had been facilitated by free internet, as you know, with 4G facilities, and the biggest role player is the smartphone. India is the second largest country of active internet user with a base of more than 540 million. Their annual spending power is in United States dollars is 300 billion. So you can imagine the stupendous amount of money that is being involved, but we are using it, the free internet, and that has certainly made it possible. So these are some of the ways that the digitization has been done, has been promoted, and is taking up very, very fast. Now I'll give you a couple of the initiatives that the tribes have taken, and they have made websites, and they have uploaded, you can also log on to this, they have uploaded these, their cultural aspects, whether it is storytelling or whether it's dance, performance, medicinal plants, anything of this sort. And these are some of the names that I'll just skip. You know, these are the important, I collected some of the important websites. The first one is the Bodo. Bodo Dimasa Archive is an online platform intended to provide language and culture resources for the Bodo and Dimasa communities of the Northeast India. It is being developed under an MOU between the National Institute of Bodology and Dimasa Scholars League, Assam University in Silchar, and North Texas University. Then this is the next is also very vibrant Dimasa website by Dr. Long Mailai, and Monali. And she's very active on Facebook, and you can see the Dimasa cultural aspects on this. Then there is a Boro one by Dr. Prafull Basumatri, which is also on the Facebook. And my own work is easily available on this website, Great Andamanese of ELR Archive, which was managed by London initially, but now it has moved to Berlin, but it's open access. So you can have any kind of, whether it is grammar related or short story related or medicinal plants related, any kind of information that you want to seek from Great Andamanese language, it's available on this website. Then my personal, there's a website which I launched many years ago called www.andamanese.net. Again, you can have, you can see there's a lot of information available, including some of the views of the Great Andamanese and so on and so forth. Then there's a recently, the very first, I should say, open access language archive. Language archive was opened by Sikkim University under this banner called Sidhela. And this has a documentation of, digitized documentation of Bhujal, Gurung, Magar, Rai, Roktum, and Sherpa languages. So you see the list is getting longer and longer every day. And sometimes people also keep informing me that, ma'am, we have also done this. For example, Karbi is also very recent. And this is a very good archive that Karbi has of language resource of the computational resource South Asian language archive. Excuse me. So languages with a digital footprint have a higher chance of survival than languages with no digital presence. When only a few speakers remain and memories of words and languages are low, speakers can reclaim and revitalize languages from digital sources. I'm quoting Shobhana Chalia. She maintains this in her new book. Digitization is a success story, let me tell you, as it involves preserving tribal heritage from the grassroots level. It's also a cooperative work, which was not done before. You see, initially the researchers used to go to the field and do research and come back. But now digitization certainly has promoted a cooperative work by the community for not only showcasing the world of their intangible heritage, but also to provide a source of pride, honor, and well-being to their folks. Currently, youth is showing interest in it, and now it has become a joint project of community members, linguists, and language lovers. To sum up, technology can be used to safeguard, revitalize, and promote endangered languages and cultures of tribes. Thank you. Thank you for listening patiently.
Thank you, Professor Abbi, for sharing your experiences with us, for your perceptive and stimulating speech on the need to preserve India's multilingual and multicultural fabric. It's a learning experience for all of us. Before we move to the next session, I would like to request our participants. Some of the participants have joined with their phone names. It will be more convenient if you could rename it so that if needed, we can address you. Thank you so much. I now invite Professor Asaduddin, Dean of the Faculty of Humanities and Languages, to deliver the presidential address. Over to you, sir. Welcome.
Thank you, Vasundhara. Professor Anvita Abbi, the keynote speaker. Professor Simi Malhotra, the head of the department. Professor I.V. Hanstack, the convener of the seminar. Vasundhara and Kanupriya, who have been trying all means, in fact, for the proper management of the event. A very good morning, and good morning to all of you. We have just heard a very scholarly and erudite presentation, full of information about how to preserve the tribal heritages in different parts of India through digitization. it is clear that when we are talking about tribes in India, they are spread out throughout the length and breadth of the country. And they are at different stages of transition. Because I think the word transition in the title is important. Professor Abbi has rightly pointed out the advantages of preserving cultures and languages through digitization, through animation, through recording of songs, through the recording of languages, so that they won't get lost. How tragic it is that we are losing some language or the other, small languages almost every other day. And but for these means of preservation, they would be lost to us forever. So I, along with others, compliment Professor Anvita Abbi, who has been at it lifelong, in fact, a lifelong commitment to preserving the languages and cultures of the tribes that are in danger of extinction. As I mentioned, that this word transition is important. I am totally ignorant about the main thrust of what she has spoken. So going further in that line would amount to merely exposing my ignorance. But because for the sake of perhaps politeness and for the sake of formality, I have to say something. So I'd like to share the story of transition of some of the tribes in the Northeast from where I come in the realm of mainly language and literature and the textualization of societies from orality. If you take the case of Arunachal Pradesh, which was earlier known as NEFA, that is Northeast Frontier Agency, which has at least 26 major tribes with their own languages, which again you find that it is very curious that these tribes, they live in close proximity and contiguity with each other, and even then their languages are mutually unintelligible. This is something which is a mystery to me, because we always say that language boundaries are porous. So what happened during the pre-independence period, educationists from Assam, they went deep into Arunachal Pradesh, taking the language and literature and almost creating and building the block of education. So quite for some time, Assamese was the lingua franca and Assamese was the language of instruction. And they also, because of the need to interact with the valley, the Assam valley, a mutually intelligible language was developed, which was known as Nephamese, right? A pidgin, which was mutually intelligible. But the fact remains that the Assamese language got so much consolidated that within a couple of decades, Arunachal Pradesh produced at least two or three writers of great renown. But that language policy changed immediately after independence, because it's a border country sharing a long border with China. And Tibet, it was understood that instead of Assamese, if Assamese was replaced by Hindi, it would be good for the security or whatever, nation building process. The merging of the periphery with the mainstream, so to say. And so for the rest of the decades after independence, there was great struggle. I am not going into details because the Assamese intellectuals and writers, and those writers from inside Arunachal Pradesh, they tried to resist. But now the situation is such that Assamese, which was the language of instruction, which was replaced by Hindi. And you can imagine that when one template is replaced by another, a lot of things change and a lot of things get lost. Similarly is the story of Nagaland, where the people developed a pidgin to exchange information and ideas with Assam, which is called Nagamese, which is used even now. And now the one is the effort to try to preserve one's own languages. The other is pragmatism, that you want to learn and acquire a language which will help you make a living. So even Naga politicians and other tribal politicians, they tell that, look here, what is the fun of spending time, so many years in learning a language, which has only speech importance, which does not give us, which is not a carrier of scholarship or serious scholarship, which cannot get us any job. So we would like our children to learn, in fact, English or Hindi. And you know that many states in the Northeast have English as their state language. Coming to the point of tribal insularity, as I say, that though these, you find that these tribes, Naga and Kuki, or Khasi and Lushai, they have lived for centuries together. And even then, one scholar once told me that the idea of translating anything from Khasi to Mizo does not make any sense because the language is so different. So it is better to translate the stuff into English so that it will be intelligible to the people. So the point is that, which we will take note, I think, during the conference, that the tribes in different parts of India are at different stages of transition. And their priorities are different, right? So preserving the culture and language, heritage language, the word itself is significant. This is one project, but at the same time, Professor Abbi has mentioned Boro and Kirby. They are still passing through the pangs of getting a permanent script, veering from Roman into Devanagari script, right? So tribes are really in a state of transition. And I hope that our deliberations in the following sessions through today and tomorrow will throw light on this very, very interesting area. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for your insightful and thoughtful, thought-stimulating speech. We have covered quite a few areas today, from Andamanese to Northeastern tribes. Now, we would conclude the session. And for the next session, we will meet at 3 o'clock. Such a wonderful and positive start to this conference. Thank you, all the esteemed speakers, Padmashri Professor Anvita Abbi, Professor Asaduddin, Professor Simi Malhotra, and Dr. I.V. Hansack, for such inspiring words, such warm welcome, and so much, there is so much information that we do not know about. Thank you all for lending so much of your time and sharing your thoughts on the subject. I would also like to extend my thanks to all the participants who have joined us for the session, especially with the webinars and online webinars where It's very difficult. You cannot, you know, have a webinar without participants. So their participation is very important. Now, before we end the first session, I would like to remind all the participants that we will commence at 3 o'clock for the next session on the same Zoom platform. You can use the same link that is provided to you, and the same link will join you to the same conference. And this will work both days. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.